Today on Simulink for Chemies, we'll go over using Simulink to model dynamic responses for second-order systems. Most chemical processes, like tanks, reactors, and heat exchangers, can be modeled as first-order transfer functions. However, if two first-order processes are placed in series, they create a second-order process, which can behave very differently from the two first-order processes on their own. All second-order transfer functions can be expressed in the general form k over tau squared s squared plus 2 zeta tau s plus 1. K is the gain, or the change in output variable divided by the change in input variable, tau is the time constant, and zeta is what's called the damping coefficient. The value of this damping coefficient zeta dictates what sort of response the process will have to a step input, whether it will be underdamped, overdamped, or runaway. So our question today is, how do the second order transfer functions, shown here on the screen, respond to a step change of 1? And what is a different possible transfer function that would trigger an unstable response from the same step change? So this question is a lot like the one in our first screencast, and if things ever feel like they're going too quickly, you can go watch that one. It deals with first order transfer functions and just an overview of how Simulink works. We have to see how the step change affects three different transfer function blocks. And Simulink is great because it'll let us plot our results. So we can go into the library and put the three transfer functions on the screen. And we also need our sink and our source. So our sink, where the signal's going, will be our scope so we can plot it. And our source of all of the signals will be the step input. And in order to take these signals and mix them together again so they can be plotted, we have to go into signal routing and get a mux. And then we'll connect all of them with the arrows. We'll go from the mux to the scope, and we'll go from the step to all three transfer functions. And we need to plot our input and our output functions simultaneously, so we have three outputs and one input, so we should have four ports on our mux block, four places to collect the signals. Spread those out a bit. One goes here. All right, now let's fill in the transfer functions. So the first one is 1 over s squared plus 4s plus 1. So it has to be in the denominator 1 space 4 space 1. The middle one should be s squared plus 2s plus 1. So that's going to be 1 space 2 space 1. The bottom one here should be 1 over s squared plus 0.5s plus 1. So before we run the simulation, what sort of response should we expect from each transfer function? So all of these transfer functions have a gain of 1 in the numerator. Tau, the time constant, is equal to 1 for all three of these transfer functions, because the tau squared coefficient on all the s squared terms is 1. And since the three functions have equal gains and equal time constants, all the differences we'll see in their behavior will come from their damping coefficients. The middle coefficient right here is equal to 2 times tau times zeta. For the top block, if 2 times tau times zeta equals 4, zeta must equal 2. This means that the top transfer function is overdamped. It will not oscillate. For the middle block, if 2 times tau times zeta equals 2, zeta equals 1. The middle transfer function, therefore, is critically damped. It won't oscillate either, but compared to the overdamped function, it will respond more quickly to the step change. The bottom block, by the same method, has a damping coefficient of 0.25. The damping coefficient is between 0 and 1, the system will be underdamped. The response will look different from the other two. It will be stable, but oscillatory. Save our model right here. We can save it as second order. Set our simulation time to 30 minutes. Press run and show our results. All right, so we can see our input step change. All of our systems eventually reach the new steady state value of 1, but in different ways. The overdamped function adjusts more slowly than the critically damped function in magenta. The underdamped function in cyan is oscillatory, but it still converges. So what about the second part of our question? What is a transfer function that would trigger an unstable response? Well, an unstable response is caused by a damping coefficient between negative 1 and 0. The damping coefficient on this bottom block is 0.25. So if we change the sign of the middle term from positive to negative, the damping coefficient will now be negative 0.25, and it should cause an unstable response. So we'll save our model, run it again, and then double-click on the scope. Wow, that is an unstable response. If you auto-scale it, and you can see the whole thing, you can see that it starts out oscillating at a reasonable level, but then as more time passes, the oscillations keep growing more and more. Well, there you go. I hope you enjoyed learning about how second-order processes can be modeled with Simulink. If you want to learn more about using Simulink to solve process control problems, you can subscribe to the Lafayette CHBE YouTube channel.